Officer for the Centre for Personal Archaeology. So it's my pleasure today to firstly acknowledge and celebrate the first Australians on these traditional lands we meet and pay my respects to the Elders, people past and present. I'd also like to thank the organisers of today's event, Christine Jeffrey, who will be here from soon. I'd like to thank Jenny Tyrrell, who's done a lot of work locally, Emma Joseph, Madeline Nicol, who's Communications Manager here for John Curtis School, Karen Gair, who's also helped, and a number of others. I'd like to thank the speakers today who have given up their afternoons to be here. I think it's a very exciting program. There's a lot of great information I think can be shared, and hopefully this is just the start of bringing together translational research and patient organisations to work together. I'd also like to thank all of you for coming today on Saturday afternoon, close to Christmas. I gather some of you have also come from far away. I'd like to thank Beth Harvey, who's come from Queensland today, and we'll hear a bit more about the great work that she's done for immunodeficiencies. And without further ado, I'd like to throw straight to Christine Jeffrey, who's the Executive Officer of IPA, to talk. But first of all, it's Emma Joseph, who's going to MC the event. So Emma, you come over and say a few words.
Full-time for IDFA, Emma and Chloe work part-time. deficiencies are diagnosed early, communities are more aware of the signs and symptoms of primary immune deficiencies, and those affected by primary immune deficiencies feel supported. Our mission is to supply information and resources to promote an understanding of primary immune deficiencies by linking members, their families and medical teams. Our values are courage, strength, engagement, determination and our members. Our goals are awareness, membership, advocacy and communication. I'm just flipping through the business model, you don't need to worry about that. What is our purpose? To raise awareness of primary immune deficiencies in the general and medical communities. To provide education, resources, practical advice and emotional support for those with PID, their carers and families. To bring the PID community in Australia together through social media, teleconferencing, patient meetings, events and conferences. And to advocate for our members, ensuring accurate diagnosis and optimal treatment to provide a better quality of life. Everything we do is based around our models of care. We have two models of care, an external or community-focused model of care and an internal patient-focused model of care. Both of our models of care are centred around our patients. So our community-focused model of care is where the patient is supported by patient-centred and evidence-based models of care. So our patients are in the middle. They're supported by their specialist medical teams. So your clinicians, your immunologists, your respiratory physicians, and especially with your immunologists, they're all part of ASPIA, which is the Australasian Society of Clinical Immunology and Allergy. And then you're also supported by us, IDFA. And then also we find that patients then form their own little support groups with each other. IDFA and ASCIA communicate regularly with each other, and we also work together. And then IDFA is also part of an international group, so we also have a lot to do with world events. And ASCIA are also part of international groups, so they are well informed in what's going on in the world. So this makes up a community-focused model of care, and that improves patient quality of life. So, in a nutshell, I'm going to give you a little example. Here is the poor patient. And the patient's been sick for a very long time, and you'll identify with this. And the patient goes, and the poor patient needs a doctor. So, not this doctor. Not that doctor. Not that doctor. Ha! Finally we get a doctor. And often this is the case. You will go through doctor after doctor after doctor before you actually get a proper diagnosis. So finally, this great immunologist sends you for the right tests. And you find out what's wrong with you. Then that doctor might also send you to other specialists. Maybe you have a respiratory specialist. Maybe you have a gastric specialist. Then that doctor will also refer you for treatment. I'm only putting subcutaneous treatment here because I can't fit both treatments in. Then you will also probably join the patient organisation, which is IDFA. We will then provide you with patient support, brochures and information. You can join a closed Facebook group. You might make some friends or buddies. You'll go on social outings with other members. And then finally you'll attend a conference. So this community-focused model, you've been supported by an evidence-based team, your immunologists, and a patient-focused group, which is ours. Then IDFA has their own patient-focused model. So we look at you, and we think, oh, this poor patient, what do our patients need? We identify different needs that patients have. And then we have a full process that we follow to address each individual need that patients have. Both these models are totally centred around our patients. So, how does the community-focused model work? It's a really good tool to view Australia's performance nationally and internationally as a PID community. It supports the relationships between patients, their clinicians, their medical teams, and patient organisations. It supports the roles of the medical team and the patient organisation. Both the medical and patient organisations work together to achieve better outcomes for patients. Both medical and patient organisations support and educate patients. Both medical and patient organisations are part of the international patient community. Both medical and patient organisations work together on joint advocacy campaigns like subcutaneous immunoglobulin and skin newborn screening. How do we know it's working? We look at the comparisons between other nations in patient organisation demographics, industry support and administration. We look at comparisons between other nations in diagnosis, access to treatment, treatment methods, optimal access to care, and patient quality of life. Our diagnosis times are improving. We look at our demographics. We look at our IDFA patient memberships and our healthcare professional memberships. Are they growing? Are they increasing? Is our PID community in Australia growing? Are we getting more patient referrals from medical specialists into IDFA? Are we having education from ASCII clinicians and IDFA? And we do, we have excellent education. Are patients feeling supported by IDFA and connecting with each other? And how is IDFA, are we part of the international community? And are advocacy campaigns successful? And again, our aim is to achieve optimal care and outcomes for patients to improve their quality of life. So I'll show you some statistics now. So in 2012, IDFA had 260 members. In July this year, we had 1,494 members. So we've actually grown 560% in 3 years. Our membership by state, well, you can see that New South Wales is leading the way. Age-wise, you can see that 45% of our members are under the age of 20. We have more females than males. Our close Facebook group has grown from 70 to 240 in 3 years. Years to diagnosis. This is really interesting. 50%, it's only taken 1 to 2 years. This is from a recent study that we did. And the study was with over about 12% of our members. So, of that group, 44% were diagnosed with CVID. We've just started a new database. We've just been converting everything from our old database to a new database, so you just have to excuse the other video. We're working our way through that at the moment. 10% with XLA, 6% IgA deficiency, 5% with IgG or subclass deficiency. Comorbidities, these are really interesting. So 26% of our patients have respiratory disorders, 8% other blood disorders, 9% neurological, 9% bowel. Now, with the treatments, I'm going to skip that slide because that was based on previous figures before the introduction of the new subcutaneous treatments. So this is just from a poll that we did recently. So 61% on IG treatment, were IVIG and 24% on SCID. So we asked how often were those people on IVIG, how often was their treatment? So 3% was second weekly, 28% 3 weekly, and 68% every 28 days. For the subcut people, 54% were doing it once a week, 33% were doing it 3 times a week, and 8% twice a week. Then we looked at how people heard about IDFA. And it's really interesting now that 28% of people hearing about IDFA are actually hearing it from other patients. Immunologists are 20% of referrals are coming from immunologists. But then if you combine that with other health professionals, which is mainly probably the nursing staff, it's 27%. So that's great. Where are they getting their education from? Well, 52% from mighty at the time, but 32% from the immunologists. So the main challenges that are facing people with primary immune deficiency: constant infections, times off school, depression, low energy levels, their other comorbidities, and family and friends not understanding. The final cost, so we, financial cost, we put an average of $3,028 per annum. So we asked the question, what do you wish you had known at the beginning of your journey that you know now? And the majority of people said they wish they'd known it was a patient support group. The other people said that most medical professionals knew nothing about primary immune deficiencies. And so these questions tell us that we should be educating GPs about primary immune deficiencies. And so for support, do you think being a member of Mighty Face helped your PID journey? And 87% of the people said yes. And so that lets us know that we're actually doing a good job by supporting our patients. So one of my other jobs is that I am on the board of the International Patient Organisation for Primary Immune Deficiencies. And so this is an international role. So let's look at Australia compared to Europe. So in size, Australia is about the size physically of the European Union, but of course if you look at the population, we're nowhere near it. We're about the size of the USA, but population-wise, nowhere near it. But if you look at the statistics, we're actually the fourth largest patient organisation within the IPOPI member organisations. That is just freaky. It's unbelievable. Compared to those other three organisations, we have the least amount of staff, and we have the least amount of funding, and we are actually one of the very youngest patient organisations. So in my role as IPOPI, I'm also the head of the Asia Pacific region. So my role is Australasia. So in that role, I look after Australia and New Zealand, and we have also been developing new patient organisations in Asia, which has been really, really interesting. So last week, I actually just got back from Hanoi, where we established the first patient organisation in Hanoi. It's very interesting to come from Australia into an Asian country, where the population in Vietnam is 90 million. These are some of their statistics. So it's interesting to note that last year they did their first stem cell transplant. That little boy is actually doing really well. They only treat their patients up to the age of 18. There's no adult treatment. But that is the amount of members that they got for their first meeting. It was just amazing. So it was very encouraging when you start a new organisation. And this is where Australia can help. You know, we help other organisations by educating them and helping them get started. Okay, so I'm going to give you an example now of how we work with ASPIA and how we work in Australia to achieve an outcome. So one of the examples was the subcutaneous immunoglobulin campaign. So I started as executive officer in 2012, and a month later I went to my first IPOPI convention. So on the other side of the world, in a country far, far away, which happened to be Italy, attending ESID, which is the medical conference, was a doctor. And I was attending IPOPI, which is the patient organisation conference. I met Associate Professor Dr. Fulcher, and he said to me, "Have you heard about SubPAP?" And I said, "No. Everyone talks about it here. What is it?" "Don't we do IVIG?" And I found out that European patients had been using SubPAP for And I thought, I better do something about this when I retire. Australia's a developed country. Our patients should have access to this treatment. How come Europe's been doing it for 20 years? How come they do it in third world countries? Why don't we do this in Australia? This is a bit unusual. Bear in mind, even though I've had a daughter with immune deficiency and she was over 20, because it wasn't done in Australia, I'd never heard of it. So, this is where we developed the patient-focused model of care. And I thought, okay, come back to Australia. I talked to our medical advisory chair, Dr. Melanie Wong. She said, yes, we've been trying to do something about this. I said, okay, patient organisation, we're going to get behind this campaign. So, the patient need was, there are treatment options for IG therapy. It's not just IVIG, there's subcut. Let's do our advocacy campaign and our community awareness. We'll educate and support this. We'll collaborate with ASCIA. We wrote letters to the Health Minister and to the NBA. We've got to implement this as a treatment option for our patients. Patients, of course, have to comply with the treatment regime. They've got to do something about it as well. So, finally, the NBA approved it. I'm not just saying this to do with us, but we were part of that whole advocacy campaign. But for patients, the outcomes are, it's a better quality of life, better trough levels, home-based therapy, less infections, it's an emotional improvement. And PID community response, they discuss it on Facebook, they recommend it to other people, they discuss the pros and cons of SCI. And of course, we're willing to the international assisted campaign. So, IDFA recognises that treatment choice is up to the prescribing immunologist and the patient. Patient comorbidities should also be considered when prescribing immunoglobulin replacement therapy. More advocacy and education material needs to be available for patients to help them understand the benefits of SCI. And the disruption of SCI products available will be a negative experience for patients, as for some last year, different products were tried before a suitable product was chosen. So, IDFA does a lot with advocacy. Some of our advocacy campaigns, we're going to advocate for IVIG at home as well. A big campaign for next year will be SCI newborn screening, and we will be doing this with ASCIA as well. So I met David Vedder, the Bubble Boys mother, this year, and she's a great campaigner for SCI newborn screening. So most of you may know what SCI is, and again, Dave will probably discuss this, and he will also discuss some of the TREC essays, I'm sure. So sponsorship and fundraising, that's the only way we can supply our resources and education for our patients. So no funding, no resources. We have increased our grants, donations and fundraising since 2012. We work with a professional fundraiser where we only retain about 15% of the sales. So it's not a great deal of money and we do a lot of work. However, there's a show coming to Canberra and all IDFA members get free tickets to the shows. So, you and your family are most welcome to come to the show. It's held at the Queen Anne Bicentennial Hall on the 10th of May. If you would like tickets, please email Emma, Chloe or myself and we can organise for you and your family to attend. So we also have grants from Ripples and CSL Berry. We do fundraising and we sell IDFA products. And it's usually my family, the Bridger families, the Tyrrells, Josephs, and the Bacton family. We're the major and only fundraisers with the IDFA, so we work pretty hard. So we've had our ball for the last 2 years where we've raised $20,000. So why should you join IDFA? For education, the support, the community, and we also want you to say, I don't feel alone. There's social value in IDFA. You can get to talk to the staff, you get a free resource pack, you become part of our community, You get to go to the conferences. The economic value of it all, we don't, there's no membership fees, the resources are free. National conference, you will pay 37%, I mean, they pay the rest. Those were our resources. We set our partners. We pay 64% for the conference. So this year at our conference, it'll be a 3-day conference in Sydney at Darling Harbour from the 8th to the 10th of July. We have an international speaker, Nizam Louis, from the Institute, the National Institute in Paris. We have a lot of different topics that will be covered. The costs for members includes your accommodation, your breakfast, your registration, which includes your morning teas, lunches, afternoon teas. It includes Friday and fun night and the conference dinner. And there's information about the conference. We also have that out at the front desk. And the program, these are just some of the things. This is what's on the program, so I'll just quickly click you through that. And we can send you a program anyway, just emails for the program. And it's all about saying, I don't feel alone. And this is the reason I'm so passionate about improving quality of life for our patients. That's our contact numbers. So thank you very much.
How's that? You all right?
Yes.
Awesome. good, actually. So thank you very much for asking me to speak. It's a reasonably difficult task to go through the whole of the immune system and talk about PID in the one lecture. So what I'm going to assume is some sort of fundamental knowledge of biology. So I'm not going to talk about the structure of the human body, even though we need to be aware of the spleen and the lymph nodes and, of course, the blood when we're talking about immunology, because that's where it's all centered on. We need to understand that tissues, those organs are divided up into various tissues, and the tissues of interest for immunologists are the connective tissue, particularly when it comes to the bone marrow and also the lymph node and, of course, blood cells. I'm going to hope that the structure of the cell is reasonably familiar in its basics to most people, and I'm sure Matt will also be happy to assume that we have some understanding of the genes within the nucleus of those cells, which gets transcribed and translated into proteins, and the makeup of those proteins are what determines how that cell works, and in the immune system, how that cell works determines how we respond to invaders. And the invaders that we are trying to respond to, which I'll refer to as pathogens throughout this lecture, basically boil down to bacteria, viruses, fungi, and protozoa. And that's what we're trying to keep out of our system. So at its most simple level, most medical staff just start laughing at this point because they think it's a bit too simplistic for them, but I don't think it's a bad idea to think that we take bugs, which we're calling pathogens, it interacts in some way, in some complex way, with the immune system and brings about a response which tends to keep us free of these things. When I talk to training specialists, which I do several times a year, I work through this side of the immune system, and over the course of a weekend or several hours, we take a journey through the whole of the immune response summarized in this cell, in this slide. Now, we're not going to do that, you'll be relieved to know, today, but we are going to go through some of the basics of how the immune system responds to infection and what can go wrong. So as far as what I'm going to talk about today is I'm going to walk you through how the immune system works. When I come to something that goes wrong in PID, I'm going to take a slight branch off and talk about that condition in one slide, and then I'm going to go back on track. And because I'm not sort of sure where you're at with understanding biology, if you want to put your hand up and ask a question at any stage, I'm really happy for that to happen. So the first stage in understanding the immune system is this idea that we are born with an intrinsic method of responding to foreign invaders. So when we walk out into a garden and step on a snail, you probably never think, well, how does that snail's immune system work? Because it survives, it protects itself from invaders. But it's turned out that even though we're not so interested in snails, it turns out that they and other insects and cockroaches and stuff have quite an interesting immune system going on, which we have a remnant of in humans and all higher organisms called the innate immune system. And the innate immune system is composed of cells and proteins, and the idea is that you see pathogens, they are recognized quickly by those cells and proteins, and rapidly bring out a response which minimizes the damage. And that works out really well if you're a fruit fly, but it doesn't work out so well if you're a rabbit or a complex human. We know that if we don't have more to our immune system than just that, we don't last in this world for more than a few months of life. And that's what Christina was referring to with SCID, where we lack this second tier of the immune system, namely Bs and T cells, which give a more specific response. So when it comes to the innate immune system, for now, we have cells, proteins, and various receptors. And when we talk about the specific immune system in a little while, we have B cells and T cells, which are essential to allow us to survive as long as we do. Now, the first step in making an immune response is having the cells, and they all begin in the marrow. You hear a lot about stem cells in the media, and in the marrow we have these what we call pluripotent stem cells, in other words, cells which can give rise to any other type of blood cell. And they divide rapidly, they give out daughter cells, which then go through a complex series of division and differentiation, and out at the end come some of these important cells which protect us from infection, including B cells and T cells, which I will talk about subsequently. So these are the players in the immune system. Lymphocytes, it's sort of colour, they don't really look like this, but lymphocytes, neutrophils, eosinophils, monocytes, basophils I won't talk about today, but I'll try to talk about some of the other ones. So if we take a drop of your blood and put it on the slide and have a look at it, you see all the red blood cells sitting around, and the most prevalent white cell that you will see is the neutrophil. And the neutrophils are basically there to protect us from bacterial infection. They're the main cell if you develop an abscess or pus formation, and basically they recognize bacteria by these receptors. They bring those bacteria or other organisms into the cell, and then they turn on a mechanism which generates high potency killers we call oxygen radicals. It's like a bleach inside the cell, if you like, and that basically disinfects the interior of the cell and kills those bugs, breaks them in bits, and that's the end of it. Unfortunately, the cell suicides in this attempt, the neutrophil dies, and that's what makes up the pus. But at least they both go down together. Now, one condition that Christina referred to, chronic granulomatous disease, there is a deficiency of one of those enzymes responsible for generating that oxygen burst within the neutrophils. It's a rare disease, probably 5 in a million at the most, depending on how hard you look for it. But basically we have 5 genes which are responsible for generating those highly toxic radicals within the cell, the bleach, if you like, which will wipe out the target. And so if you're missing one or more of these enzymes, you can't do that. And so the neutrophil brings the bug into the cell but can't kill it. And that is a major problem for the host. So most of these are on the X chromosome. That means that men are predominantly affected or excluded. So this usually presents in childhood. You get recurrent infections with bacteria and some nasty fungi, liver abscess, skin abscess, pneumonia, and sometimes gut involvement. And the treatment, antibiotics, and sometimes if you're on gamma, which I think that's just interesting in your slide, because there's a lot of the things I'm going to talk about, a lot of the treatments I'm going to talk about are actually listed as if you're on gamma. Now, eosinophils are to protect us from worms. We actually don't fully need these cells, and unfortunately, they cause problems in allergic disease. But they're not really a big player in immune deficiency, but I mentioned them on the way through. Now, macrophages are, on the other hand, very important. So you'll see this macrophage, it takes a while to get going, but these are all the bugs that he's trying to deal with. The idea of macrophages is that they recognize foreign invaders and then bring them inside the cell, break them up, as we've seen neutrophils do, and then chew them out and spit them out onto the surface in contact with other receptors which then turn on T cells. So macrophages are terribly important in initiating specific immune response as well as killing the targets in their own right. Now I don't want to get too detailed, but there are other types of cells which recognize viruses and release other chemicals called, for example, interferon, which protect us from viral infections whilst the virus is there. So if you have a really bad flu, for example, and you feel lousy, part of the reason for that is that the body is churning out interferons, which shut down a lot of the cells in the body and make them less permissible for those viruses to multiply. Now, we don't want to feel like that all the time, but just when the virus is hitting the immune system, the interferons take over for a little while, and then they go back to where they were. So we have a number of other protection from the environment in the innate immune system, and part of that is proteins, and we have a number of structures that are released from the body in response to infection or in a sort of resting steady state, which just act to block invaders coming in. One of those is MBL. We have a condition of MBL deficiency. It's not very important. There's certainly plenty of patients and plenty of community members which have very low levels, and we don't have 8% of people having immune deficiency. So it's a very subtle immune defect, but I just put it up to illustrate that all aspects of the immune system, or many aspects of the immune system, can fail and cause some problems in some people. And if two of those minor abnormalities, or two or three of them, come together, then that may cause a more significant immune deficiency. Now we have the system of complement. I won't labour the point, because it's a complex system, and most medical people, when they come to the complement chapter, just go on to the next one because it's too hard to understand. But essentially it's a series of cascading proteins which are activated by bugs or by antibody and convert to active components which target or coat the bug and help them to be taken up by the macrophage and killed, or they drill holes in the surface of the bacteria and kill it that way. So they're highly potent molecules, and although complement deficiency is rare, it was on your list, and is still occasionally looked for. The most feared one, of course, is meningococcus, and a number of complement deficiencies can make you susceptible to meningococcus. And a lot of immunologists will routinely screen patients who have recovered from meningococcal pneumonia or meningitis for this deficiency. Sort of a little bit of a moot point, because you can't really replace the complement components, but it is, I think, worth knowing whether that deficiency is present. Much more common that we see a fair bit of is hereditary angioedema, where patients, and this is sort of classified as an immunodeficiency, although they don't get infections. It is a deficiency of an immune component, one of the control proteins of complement. So if they are lacking in this control protein, the complement system takes off unopposed, and they get inflammatory or swelling reactions within target tissues at random sort of times. And we have reasonable treatments for this. So that's all I want to say about the innate intrinsic immune system that underpins a more complex specific immune system involving antibodies, B cells and T cells. Now the first step in this process is to take the bug which has tried to invade the body and move it to an area where the immune response can occur. So that's usually the task of the dendritic cell, which sits out in the skin or surface lining of the body and looks for its target. And when it sees it, it does two things. It takes it into the cell, like you saw the macrophage doing, breaks it down into bits and puts it on the surface to activate T cells. And the other thing it does is hold it on the surface and takes it down to the lymph nodes where all the B cells and T cells are circulating through and activate them. So let's talk about what I've referred to and what's most important, I think, for most people in this room, and that is the antibodies. Now, these are proteins which are produced by the lymphocyte that I referred to previously as B cells, and we have an army of millions of different, subtly different types of antibodies circulating all the time. Now, these antibodies vary at this end, which is the part of this molecule which binds onto the bacteria or virus or protozoan. And because each one is slightly different, they can bind different pathogens in different circumstances. And so we have a wide variety of antibodies which protect us from a wide variety of pathogens. And once they bound to those pathogens, they can activate other parts of the immune system and get the thing going on. So the binding of an antibody is sort of like a hand in glove or hand around an apple in this case, where the antibodies bind. So we start with a sort of fairly basic molecule of antibody that we call IgG, and we have a number of variations on that which are relevant in patients with immune deficiency. So the IgM is sort of a bigger version of IgD multiplied by 5 times, so that each one of those can bind its target pathogen. So IgM's sort of good at that. And IgA, I'll talk about briefly, protects the body from invasion. So it coats the surface of the body and stops bugs from getting in. IgM comes up very quickly after infection. IgG is a little bit later. So IgM is produced by the body early to protect us from that early phase, and IgG is a better antibody that comes a bit later and protects us from future infections. So IgG is very much the most prevalent in serum, and we have very, or rather constant levels in the bloodstream which immunologists will measure to determine whether this aspect of the immune system is working. So when you come, if you are on gamma globulin, when you come to your monthly checkup, they will normally check, or 6 monthly checkup, and normally look back through your IgG levels to make sure that there are sufficient levels to protect you from infection. Now, some of you getting fancy about this and getting into a slightly cloudy territory will have heard of G subclass deficiency. It sort of goes in and out of vogue, but IgG has four sort of slight structural variations, and these variations are present in different quantities in the serum. And they have some different roles. Some antibodies are better at responding to proteins and other to sort of these complex sugars. And this thought of being deficient in one or more of these, I'll talk about shortly. IgA has a double whammy. It's produced, the body actually produces more IgA than any other type of antibody because it has to protect body surfaces. And IgE, we mostly see in allergy. It's not such a big thing in immune deficiency, except for, of course, hyper IgE syndrome, which has nothing really to do with IgE, but it's one of the characteristic features. So we have this deficiency of this molecule, which we call STAT3, and basically STAT3 is very important to protect us from Candida and staph. STAT3 is important in generating T cells, which will protect us from Candida and staph. And so if you lack those T cells, which we call Th17 cells, you get eczema, pneumonia, problems with your bone and teeth, and we have some standard treatment for that. These abnormalities of bone and teeth will give you a characteristic appearance from this classic photo from the 80s. All right, so antibodies are produced by B cells, and as I mentioned earlier, B cells develop in the marrow, and then when they come out through these various stages of development, they have antibody on the surface of them, and each B cell will be slightly different, because they'll have a slightly different antibody on their surface as they emerge from the marrow. So then those B cells go out into the periphery. There's a whole army of B cells. When a pathogen comes in, it binds to the one whose receptor it matches. That B cell expands and goes on to produce antibody, which then protect us from infection. Now, one of the problems with that can go wrong in that process is typified by XLA or Grubbins at gamma, where you are lacking a protein necessary for the early stages of lymphocyte development to generate the B cells which are necessary in the periphery. So if you are lacking some of these proteins, your B cells cannot develop past this stage, so you don't, in the marrow, so you don't get circulating B cells, and therefore you get very little, if any, antibody formation. So that's called Grubbins agammaglobulinemia, or X-linked agammaglobulinemia. As mentioned, they lack B cells, it's X-linked, just like chronic granulomatous disease, as I mentioned earlier. So boys, mostly, almost exclusively boys, and girls are carriers. So no B cells, no antibody, and the antibodies that get passed through the placenta from the mother will protect the child for the first 6 months, but as they wear out, the child cannot make their own antibodies, and they start to get infections from about that time. So they do okay on replacement. So as I mentioned, the B cells leave the marrow, they go to the lymph nodes and spleen, they look for their target. When they see their target, they expand, and this generates a population of B cells ready to fight the invader by making antibody. So those B cells then turn into what we call plasma cells. These are the antibody factories which sit in the marrow, churn out antibodies for a very prolonged period of time and protect from future invaders. And they also generate memory cells which remember that particular antigen and respond much faster next time they're exposed. So in this second stage of B cell development, outside the marrow, there are many more immune deficiency conditions which result from problems. So the antibody deficiency syndromes as a whole result in failure of antibody levels total, and they fail in their appropriate immune response to infection, particularly with vaccination. So patients tend to get recurrent infections of the respiratory tract, pneumonia, bronchitis, sinusitis, little ear infections, and also of the gut. And there's this intriguing association with autoimmunity and lymphoma and gastric cancer, which clinicians look out for. So the most common, of course, is common variable immunodeficiency, or CVID, and this is common for an immunologist. Everyone else thinks this is not very common, but there are certainly a large number of patients in any one hospital with this diagnosis. It's variable, so each patient will have slightly different manifestations, and we are getting better, and Matthew will talk about this, I think, at explaining it. It's clear that there are a lot of different genetic problems which will give this diagnosis, and they vary from person to person, which is why the disease is so variable, we think. And I think as time goes on, we may be explaining many more than the 25% that we currently have the potential to do. The part of the work of the CPI is to look for new genetic explanations for the patients with otherwise unexplained antibody deficiency. So many of you will be aware of, I've spoken about the subcutaneous and intravenous immunoglobulin as the right treatment. Much more common but less of a clinical problem is IgA deficiency. So an Australian study showed this to be present in 1 in 700. When you think about what IgA does, remember from a few slides back, it protects the mucosal surfaces, the surfaces of the body. It If you lack IgA, it's not too surprising that you are at risk of getting infections. But we don't have one in 700 people running into problems, so a lot of patients with IgA deficiency will never get a problem. Only if it's combined perhaps with other abnormalities of the immune system will it usually present itself. So most hospitals will have many more CVIDs than IgA deficiencies because these guys don't usually run into problems. But there are some important links to other conditions which I don't think are fully explained, but nevertheless clearly occur. And I might, in the interest of time, not venture into the controversial area of subclass deficiency. It's not quite clear whether this entity does indeed exist or not. Probably not as frequent as we thought it was, but I think there are some patients who clearly have it. And finally, very few of your patients have this pristine specific antibody deficiency, even less sort of well-defined or understood than the other fully understood conditions. Basically, they get similar infections with, especially often pediatric, with other antibody deficiency states, recurrent infections of the respiratory tract. But when you test their antibody levels and their B cells, they're all present normally, but they don't respond well to vaccination for reasons which aren't particularly clear. All right, so in the last 2 minutes, T cells, I showed you where T cells came from in the marrow. Those precursor T cells migrate to the thymus, which is this organ above the heart in the mediastinum, where those T cells are selected to be functional. They go through a series of complicated selection stages and they emerge as either CD4 helper T cells or CD8 cytotoxic T cells, and some of those CD4 expressing cells are regulatory, which is relevant in some rare disorders. So CD4 just refers to a type of T cell which helps, and CD8 is a type of T cell which kills virally infected cells usually. So like B cells, these T cells express a unique receptor on their surface which allow them to respond to degraded antigen by dendritic cells or macrophages, so broken down pathogens presented in the way I alluded to earlier by these major immune activating cells. And the helper cells control the immune response by releasing various messengers we call cytokines, and that coordinates the attack against the invader. So this is the most feared, most severe, nasty immune deficiency that immunologists will encounter. And basically, there's a genetic abnormality which results in complete lack of T cells and the inability to fight off these types of pathogens. So patients will present with recurrent, severe, life-threatening infections, chronic diarrhea, weight loss, and unless they are transplanted quickly, they will not survive. And the studies have shown that if you wait until they have those infections, the outcome is a lot poorer. So many states in the United States have initiated newborn screening for this condition with the thought that if we pick those children up and transplanted them prior to developing any infection, that they will do much better. And by and large, that hypothesis has been borne out. It's quite clear that the earlier you recognise this condition, the better the children will do, but you only recognise it when they present with their first infection, where they do worse after transplantation than otherwise. So I think it's very commendable that IFFA and ASCIA are working together to try to introduce newborn screening into this country. There are multiple genetic causes. Most of them are, again, X-linked, but there are a number of other abnormalities which can explain this condition in some people. And I referred to that. And the major treatment, essentially, is bone marrow transplantation. We do some gene therapy in this country. I don't regard this condition because I'm an adult physician, and this is always pediatric. that we do some of this, but not as big as other areas in Europe and the US. So only two conditions that I wanted to mention. I told you about this type of T cell we call Th17 cells, which are responsible for fighting off candida. So there are a number of very intriguing genetic abnormalities affecting the generation of these types of CD4 T cells, and one of which is CMC, or primary cutaneous candidiasis, where they have this defect in candida immunity because of the genetic lack of these cells. And there are a number of different genes that we can now look for that, that are responsible for that abnormality. And finally, hyper-IgM syndrome. You do have a few patients on your list, Christina, who had this diagnosis. Most of them are X-linked. And one of the things I mentioned is once you've activated the B cell, it needs to get T cell help before it can go further and make antibody. And hyper-IgM syndrome is due to the failure of T cells helping B cells. And so the B cells, while they're responding, they can't actually do anything much more than that. They also get sort of bad infections because the T cells aren't themselves activated appropriately. And these children actually don't do anywhere near as well as the standard hypogammas or CBRDs, and often get very unwell. And transplantation is certainly on the cards for some of them. So this is mostly a slide for doctors. I don't do any, unfortunately, GP education, but I do specialist physician education, and I always put this slide up to remind doctors of the things to look out for. It was incredibly concerning to me, Christina, that your second most highest beef was that doctors know nothing about PID, and I think that's by and large probably true. The one main reason is that these disorders aren't terribly common in the day-to-day practice. But this is isn't a fantastically useful thing, but it just raises people's awareness, doctors' awareness of the things to look out for. So with that, I will finish and thank you for giving me the time to talk about that, and hopefully you can take any questions if you have any. Thank you.
So that was one of the earliest thoughts that was introduced in chronic fatigue syndrome, came to be thought about, I think in around about the 80s. And there was similarity between patients who were on interferon injections and the same sort of tiredness that chronic fatigue syndrome patients got. And it was the basis of a number of attempted interventions. I think it's fair to say that by and large that hypothesis hasn't borne out, and patients with chronic fatigue syndrome are found to have similar cytokine levels to everybody else. But it was a thought at one stage.
Most of what David spoke about is within our patient's handbook. which is available outside if you wanted to write your name down and we can send you one in the mail. Alright, so take a seat, everyone. Thank you. So, Professor Matthew Cook is a co-director of the Centre for Personal Life Immunology here at the John Curtin School of Medical Research at the Australian National University, and is a practicing immunologist and head of department at the Canberra Hospital. He has published over 60 peer-reviewed articles and is a member of ASCIAM, the Australasian Society of Clinical Immunology and Allergy. He also provides regular advice to the government and health departments through the National Health and Medical Research Council. So please welcome Professor Matthew Cook.
Thanks very much, Emma, and Christine. Well done on organising this and your overall efforts. I think the attendance here today is a testament to the good work you're doing. And, you know, we can't estimate the importance of patient support networks, so well done. Okay, so I'm just going to talk a little bit about the approach that we take to try and elucidate the primary immune deficiency diseases that remain unexplained. And David's just given you a very nice overview of the complexity of the immune system and introduced some of those that we do understand. And it's true to say that over the past 25 to 30 years, identification of the genetic basis of primary immune deficiency has been a fairly successful endeavour. But it remains incomplete, and there are many forms of primary immune deficiency that remain unexplained. Now, this is a summary of a typical approach to medicine that takes place not just in immunology clinics, but other sorts of clinics as well. People present with some sort of complication, some sort of damage to some part of the body, say ear pneumonia, and this prompts the doctor to do a blood test and some sort of abnormality is detected. And so in the context of immune deficiency, it might be that someone presents with pneumonia. The doctor has the insight to actually measure antibody levels and might find that they're low and then arrives at a diagnosis of immune deficiency. But often that's the end of the story. The diagnosis is made, antibody deficiency is diagnosed, and we don't proceed to try and make a more precise diagnosis according to the principles of immunology that we understand that David has just discussed. Now, so the Centre for Personalised Immunology, or the CPI, aims to identify genetic variation in patients who have primary immune deficiency. We're not working exclusively on primary immune deficiency, we're also working on some other disorders of the immune system. And I'm happy to discuss at the end how working on a number of different sorts of immune disorders is a complementary approach. And our aim is to identify the genetic variants and prove that these genetic variants are linked to the dysfunction of the immune system that causes the clinical presentation. And then if we identify those, then we can try and determine how prevalent those abnormalities are in the entire group of individuals who have primary immune deficiency. All right, so we have to tackle a little bit more biology, I'm afraid, to understand what we do. Okay, so within every cell in the body, whether it's a skin cell or a kidney cell or a brain cell, we have a nucleus. And the nucleus contains the genetic material. And the genetic material is arranged into chromosomes. And the chromosomes, in fact, contain remarkable molecules called DNA. the DNA is packaged into chromosomes, and within the DNA we can identify segments that we refer to as genes. So DNA includes genes, and genes occur along the length of the DNA. The DNA is packaged in chromosomes, and chromosomes are located in the nucleus. So here we have the 23 pairs of chromosomes. We can break up a cell, break up the nucleus, and look down the microscope and identify the chromosomes. And we've got the longest one here, chromosome 1, here, and we've got pairs of chromosomes, you'll notice. So each cell has one pair of each chromosome, and then when a cell divides, the pairs separate and replicate one another so that each daughter cell acquires exactly the same genetic complement as the parent cell. Now that happens in every cell in the body except the germ cells, right? Except the cells, the sperm and the ova cells, the cells which are important in reproduction. And during reproduction, things are a bit more complicated because there is shuffling of genes that take place. So those chromosomes, which are shown schematically here, pair up, and then there is this event that takes place where chromosomes break, they pair up, and then they can exchange segments across two different chromosomes. And this is why our children are not identical to us, because we get this shuffling of genetic material with each generation. Now, the genome is pretty large. It contains the information that specifies how we are formed, and we've got all these chromosomes, and as I said, the chromosomes are made up of DNA. So here's an example. Here's one chromosome, chromosome 5, and chromosome 5 contains 900 genes. And the DNA, just on that one chromosome, contains 180 million signals on a basis. And if we look at across the entire genetic makeup, then we estimate that humans have about 22,000 genes, and the total number of signals is about 3 billion. So there's a lot of information in the human genome. All right, now, what we need to try and do if we're trying to understand the genetic basis of disease is to look at what happens within a family, understanding as we do how this genetic shuffling takes place, how this reassortment of genetic information takes place, and then try and infer from a family tree like this one what might actually be going on in order to try and identify where the genetic abnormality is located. So some of you, especially those interested in genealogies, family trees, might be familiar with this sort of diagram, but essentially we've got a line for each generation. So this one shows four generations. Females are the circles and males are the squares, and siblings are linked by this bar here. And then we've got two parents of the next generation. And we can use this sort of shorthand way of summarising what might actually be going on. So here you can see we've got these semi-filled symbols to indicate members of a family that might be affected by some normal condition. And so you can see that there are affected members in all four generations. It's being transmitted and every generation is affected. Now here's another kindred, but it's a bit different. Again, we've got four generations, but you can see that there is an affected family member here and another one here, but then there's no affected members in other parts of the kidney. So what's going on? So if we come back to what I've told you about the chromosomes, we can try and work out how this could come about. So here we've got chromosomes from the two parents in this generation, and what I've indicated here are some variations across the chromosomes. So we've got variations scattered, this is an oversimplification, but because remember I said that there were 900 genes on this chromosome alone, but we've got some variation here, and then I've just indicated that there is a particular variant indicated with the red bar. Now, in the next generation, you can see that these two individuals each have a version of this red bar. And so, in the subsequent generation, there's a chance that one of the offspring from these two parents might have two copies of this red bar, and this will result in the manifestation of the condition. So I'll have two abnormal copies of the gene. Right, so some disorders require both chromosomes to carry an abnormality. That's called an autosomal recessive disorder. And these disorders occur in a kindred like this, where there might be one affected member, but the parents are not affected, or the parental generations. And then there are other conditions where one abnormal copy is sufficient. And that, like the previous pedigree I showed you, can affect every generation. And they're referred to as autosomal dominant disorders. All right, now, up until quite recently, the way that we tried to identify the genes that were responsible for conditions like primary immune deficiency, even when we had a large number of kindreds like this that told us that there was a single gene that must be going wrong to cause the disorder, was still a pretty difficult task because of the magnitude of the genome, 3 billion bases, remember. So what we had to do up until quite recently was to look for markers across the entire genome, across all of the chromosomes, to see if we could find markers that segregated with the disease. So we could do this sort of analysis, looking for markers across the chromosomes, to see when two markers lined up in individuals who were affected, but not in anyone else in the family. And this led us to the region of the genome that might harbour the cause of genetic abnormality. But it was still a huge task to get beyond that to find the actual abnormal gene. Well, in the past 6 or 7 years, it's become possible to not just look for markers across the entire genome, but to actually read the code of the entire DNA makeup of an individual. So we can read those 3 billion bases. Or we can concentrate on the bits of the DNA that just make up the genes, which is remarkably only about 2% of this, but it means the task is more manageable. Now, again, this is not necessarily straightforward. If you go outside at afternoon tea time and look across to the next building, you'll see what's called the National Computational Infrastructure. This is the largest supercomputer in the southern hemisphere in that building, and that's where we do our analysis. And if we wanted to process all through the 3 billion bases, it takes us about 1,000 hours on that supercomputer, the largest supercomputer in the southern hemisphere. So this is still not a straightforward task. But it is possible, and this is the recent history that's led to this remarkable progress. So you'll probably be aware that the human genome sequence was announced just at the turn of the century, and that basically provided the entire sequence, and that took about 15 years to arrive at, and it took about $35 billion. But now, with developments in methods, we can read the sequence of a human genome in, as I said, in a measurable period of time, which is considerably shorter than it was, and it's also considerably cheaper to do, fortunately, than $35 billion. Right, so here's an analogy of where we've how we've made progress. So this is a satellite photo from 2006, and so look at this satellite photo, and we can we might see something of interest here in Southern California. Say, oh well, there might be something of interest in San Diego. And this is like the old-fashioned approach to identifying somewhere in the genome where something might be going wrong. Well, now any of us can look at San Diego and drill down and look at every house on the street, and this is essentially what we can do now with genome sequencing. We can look at every house as a base. We can look specifically at every one of those, and we can look at every one in the world. So why would we do this? Why is it so important to identify these abnormalities in the genome sequence? Why are we putting so much effort into doing this when it's such an enormous task? Well, the genes encode what's called RNA, and RNA is an intermediate to making proteins. So the genes encode all of the proteins in the body. Proteins that are enzymes, the structural proteins that hold our bones together, or transmit signals within the cells, or switch DNA on and off. And here's a simplified version of a cell. Again, like David, I use this in lectures to medical students to scare them off. But this is still a simplified version of what's going on. But there are lots and lots of signals that are taking place in a cell in order for it to work properly. And all of these different components are encoded by separate genes. So if we can work out where there's an abnormality in the gene, then we stand a chance of working out how the cell is going wrong. Now, we're all very different to one another. Not only is the genome extremely large, but once we start to look at the amount of variation in the genome, we find that we all vary a lot from one another. So here are a few of the first genomes to be sequenced. This was Craig Venter, who was responsible for sequencing the human genome initially. James Watson, who discovered the structure of DNA. In the 1950s, Desmond Tutu. Well, these three individuals had their genome sequenced, and this gave us an early indication of the extent of variation between different individuals. So if we just concentrate on the genes in the genome, we can identify usually about 8,000 variants in each individual. All right, so with all of that sort of information, now what we're trying to do with the CPI is to, is when someone presents with features that might suggest an immune deficiency, and we do a blood test which confirms our suspicion, then we can start to proceed all the way down to understand how things are going wrong, to explain in molecular terms and cellular terms in the way that David has outlined for, we've already made progress for some diseases, in all of the diseases that can lead to immune deficiency. So this is the these are the mugshots of the CPI, and you might think it's been running for 10 years based on the appearance of some of these individuals. But in fact, the CPI is a relatively recent development, but it represents the represents the outcome of lots of work which has been going on over the past decade in primary immune deficiency diseases and in some other immunological disorders by investigators shown here, different centres around Australia and around the world. And we got together because we realised that a similar sort of approach was likely to be informative. Now, a lot of the preliminary work that we were able to do in primary immune deficiency was performed as part of the ANZARDA study, which some of you may have heard of, or may in fact be enrolled in. So this is a study specifically to investigate the genetic abnormalities that occur in primary antibody deficiency. And this is a large national effort. Approximately 650 people have been enrolled in this so far. Now, we got this study off the ground based on some seed funding from various sources, including the Harvey bequest, which was so crucial in enabling us to get things moving. And we've been able to secure some extra funding from the National Health and Medical Research Council in recent years as well. Now, the overall strategy of the CPI is, as I've already outlined, to identify genetic variants, to understand how those genetic variants lead to abnormalities of cellular function. But I've also mentioned that there is this enormous array of genetic variation in each of us. And even once we've catalogued the genetic variation in an individual, it's still quite a big task to try and work out how that causes disease, and indeed whether we're looking at the correct variant. So there's one more piece to this puzzle, which has really been a crucial technical development which has come about in the past couple of years. And again, this has found its way into the popular media because it's been such a revolution for biological discovery, and it's highly likely that the discoveries of this mechanism will receive a Nobel Prize far into the future. And this is a mechanism which enables the genetic makeup to be engineered, and this means that we can take a cell line in a lab or a mouse model, and we can engineer a genetic variant to study whether that genetic variant really is responsible for causing an abnormality of the immune system. And this enables us to prove whether that particular genetic variant is responsible. And so this helps us to close the loop from identifying genetic variants, proving that they're responsible for causing abnormalities of the immune system, characterising those abnormalities, and then explaining how they cause immune deficiency. All right, so this is the current approach to immune deficiency. Often depends on identifying signs of dysfunction of immunity, and and what we need to do is to really connect how those abnormalities that we can detect in the diagnostic laboratory are accounted for by more fundamental changes in the signaling pathways within the cell and how they're specified within the genome. And of course, if we can do this, then it means that diagnosis becomes more accurate. We can make a diagnosis before necessarily any complications occur. And it also opens up the opportunity for new approaches to treatment. Right, so thank you very much for your attention.
Outside, grab a few snacks and some bathroom, and we'll see you back here with Steve.
We'll check them on the main one first.
Yeah.
And then we've only got like four people.
I was thinking
perhaps
like sorry.
Yes, you can use them in the middle. And then I just copy you.
But I'm still undecided whether I'm in the meeting or whether I'm there just talking.
Up to you. Everyone.
Like you're about to give them scores on the X Factor.
Sorry?
I'll give them a 10 to hold on.
Your recording's going well. We've been able to see it all.
So you're the one logging in, is it?
No, it's not me. The young lady that's sitting out there.
Who's watching it?
Chloe.
Thank you.
So we've had a couple.
We've been watching it on YouTube.
We've had a couple of cutouts, but it's been all right.
Okay. Well, she said that the only thing she said is.
It sounds a bit soft.
She didn't seem to think that was a problem. No, she seemed to think that was fine.
There should be one PowerPoint presentation on there and a lot of baby photos.
And what's the baby photo?
Ultrasound.
The baby photos will keep everybody.
No, they're ultrasound images, so they're not
real baby photos. Baby
photos. It was the only memory stick I could find at home. I don't really use them very much anymore. Because work has banned them, and if you plug them into the computer, they won't work.
Oh, is that right?
My work got too worried that they were going to bring in viruses and things. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Don't put another one.
Oh, yeah.
long as you do everything well with this.
Okay. So you can just as the slideshow so no one else can see the notes, change the name, and that number 10. Thank you. I'll start with the same board director chair, because I've just resigned as chair of the chair.
I'll come out in a minute. I just want to set this up, let people know that we'll be back in 3 o'clock. Right?
So, right, so they show up.
Yep. You have the work for this?
Expecting a hostile audience?
I don't know, should I? With the product changes.
I
surprised they recovered.
I think the thing was,
that's the next great adventure. So,
yeah.
National Blood Authority Australia. The National Blood Authority ensures a secure supply of blood and blood products in Australia and is responsible for immunoglobulin product authorisation and management. So let's welcome Michael.
Thank you. And it's a pleasure to be here to tell you about what we do at the MBA a little and to explain the recent changes or the forthcoming changes, depending on which hospital you're in, to immunoglobulin supply. We don't often get to meet the people who are right at the end of what we're responsible for, so it's a real pleasure to be here. I thought I would mention a couple of things about what the MBA does, because you may never have actually heard of us before. We'll talk about the context in which we do the tendering for national IG contracts, IG immunoglobulin, of course. I'll talk about the recent process, how we do the process, the sort of criteria we apply. Just talk about the outcomes and the timetable. And there are a couple of other things going on around immunoglobulin that I'll just mention briefly. Hopefully I won't sound too much like a public servant. So the MBA was set up in 2003 when there was a review called the Stephen Review that saw the need for a single national body to do contracting and planning and I guess provide supply security around the provision of blood and blood products in Australia. So we're a Commonwealth authority, but we are responsible to the Commonwealth, state and territory governments. The governments provide us with policy direction, I guess. They approve the products that are on the list that we then go and purchase. They provide the funding. So it's the products are provided on a cost-shared basis. 63% is Commonwealth funding, 37% is state and territory funding. And of course, the states and territories run the health systems. So our products, the products we contract for, then get delivered into the health systems, and the states and territories and the private sector are responsible for those. So we do national demand forecasting. We have a national supply plan. We frame a budget for each year. We, importantly for today, we do national tendering and contracting for product supply. And that's really my main job. And it's, I suppose, one of the real core functions of the MBA. We also get involved in processes around governance of blood and blood products in the health system, the management and use of those products. So we've had quite a big program in developing clinical guidelines for fresh products, red cells, platelets, etc. And we get involved quite a lot with specialist clinicians and specialist groups. We also have some systems in place to support the efficiency of the supply chain. We look at data that we have access to, we do analysis, and we support government decision making. But the national tendering and contracting is really central point today. Just very briefly around why immunoglobulin and in particular the imported products for today are so important to us. At a couple of places, two or three places, I'll have a website to have a look at. If you want to look at our publications around immunoglobulin supply analysis of the data we have, they're on our website at that site. So in 2013-14, just a few statistics, there are around just under 14,000 patients in Australia receiving immunoglobulin. Now, that covers a range of clinical areas, neurology, hematology, some transplantation medicine. It covers the areas relevant to IDFA and primary immunodeficiency, but also other immune diseases, more acute. So there's quite a range of patients in there. Now the total cost under our budget that year was $27 million. Our budget is around about $1 billion for blood and blood products nationally. And so in 2013-14, that was 43% of the total budget. Now that is made up of domestic product, as we call it, which is immunoglobulin made from plasma, which is collected in Australia by the Red Cross Blood Service and then manufactured into IVIG or subcutaneous IG, Intragam or Evergam, by CSL in Melbourne. and also imported products, because Australia doesn't actually collect and manufacture. You're actually quite a high user internationally of IVIG. Personally, I think that's a good thing. It means that Australia has taken the policy step of providing good therapy for patients who need those products. We're one of the top three countries in the world, as far as I know. Demand has been growing 11% a year. 11% is a bit higher than the population rate, as you'd probably be aware. So that does concern some people. Exactly what the explanation of that is multifactorial. There's 60 or so broad conditions in here. It's very hard to put your finger on one factor. Just interestingly, on this slide, you'll see this, the light area is getting bigger and bigger. So that is the component of immunoglobulin each year, which is imported to meet demand. It just is all to show that imported IVIG, i.e. the tender we just ran, is central to what we do. Total IVIG next year is going to be a big chunk of our budget. Sorry, going a bit fast. If we project out, this is now cost. If we project out, wrong button. We'll have $220 million odd by 2018-19 imported IG, and we'll be getting close to 50% of product imported. So, in terms of tendering, there's a few words on here, sorry about that, but I'll just go through the point. So we have had imported IG supply contracts in place more or less since we started in 2003. The first national tender we ran was in 2004. There was a very limited supply market in Australia at that point, other than the domestic product from CSL. Some of you may remember CSL were importing a powdered product, Sandoglobulin, and then around 2004, Octopharma became active in Australia. Over the years since then, there's been this very encouraging interest from the global market in Australia. And so by the time we get to 2014 and the recent tender, we have a very competitive tender, which really yields us good results in terms of price outcomes. We've had to do some odd things every now and then. So you may recall, or you may remember, that there was a product recall in 2011. And so we had to step outside a normal tendering process another supplier. So we do manage supply contingency. A large part of what we do is about supply risk and supply contingency, as well as basic tendering and pricing. And then subcutaneous IG was introduced in 2013 alongside intravenous IG, and we introduced those products into the supply arrangements. So typically we are tendering, now I'm talking about the imported side, not the domestic side. Typically, we're tendering in every 3 to 5 years, and we do a lot of information gathering. It's a pretty constant thing, really, but particularly coming up to when we're deciding to tender, we'll go and request information from all the supply companies. We'll have a consultation with stakeholder groups, IDFA and similar groups, clinical groups, and in fact, individual patients are quite welcome to respond to those consultations when we put them out. So what we do is get the best set of information we can about how to run a tender, what are the factors to take into account, what are the commercial sort of moves we should make to try and get the best commercial outcome. We then take a set of parameters, if you like, to governments, and they endorse those. So for example, in our recent tender, we said that we'd be going for 2 or 3 imported suppliers for each of intravenous IVIG, IG and subcutaneous IG. If we could achieve that, we try to have products with a consistent price. We try and get a range of product characteristics so that that would enable clinical flexibility where that was needed. Then we go into a tender process, and we generally have involvement from stakeholder groups. When I'm saying stakeholders here, I'm really talking about specialist clinician groups. In this tender we've just run, we had an immunology representative, a neurology representative, and a specialist IVIG nurse on our tender evaluation panel, as well as MBA representatives and a state and territory rep. So we have a multi sort of focus approach in our tender evaluation. And just to note that we are only on about purchasing products for the Australian arrangements which are registered by the TGA in Australia, of course, as you'd expect. And TGA standards, because we're talking imported products, TGA standards for registration are exactly the same between domestic and imported products these days. 15 years ago it wasn't quite the same, but nowadays these are harmonised global standards and we're buying products from a mainstream global industry with a high safety standard. You may say, well, what happened in 2011 with Octagam? But in fact, that was an issue which was picked up quickly and responded to quickly by, in terms of other, if you look at other issues which arise sometimes in pharmaceuticals. So these are the criteria we apply in our tender. We look at the companies, of course. This may be a little detailed, but I think it's useful for you to know how we decide these things. So we look at the companies, are they going to be a viable and secure supplier? We look at their systems, their support arrangements. I'll go into a little bit more detail. And of course we look at price. So this may be of the most interest. So you see that when we're looking at things like product support, there are a range of elements here which enhance supply security. So we want inventory holdings. We want each supplier to give us a preferred customer status in Australia. So if there's a problem in their supply chain and they have to choose which country to direct product to, they'll direct it to Australia. We have reserves built in through the supply chain. We have a KPI framework for how they perform in their deliveries and the ordering process. We have an obligation that if they can, they'll support supply product to people who are temporarily overseas. So we have a range of things around product support, as well as where I would expect parts to turn in their computer, just good basic product support in terms of materials and the facilities they provide to support clinicians and hospitals. And then when we go to the product side, of course we want an absolutely clear regulatory position for any products we're buying. And in this recent tender, we have this list here of factors which we looked at about the clinical acceptability and the fitness for purpose of the product. So these are things, having talked to clinicians in our consultations, these are things which go to making slight qualitative differences between the products. Not necessarily in their final efficacy, but things like the storage temperature and conditions can be quite a useful aspect in terms of managing product stocks in hospitals or even at home if you're using subcutaneous product at home. So we go through those factors through a very extensive tender process and come up with the final answer. So in this recent tender which we ran in 2014, it was gratifying really that we did have a very strong field of tenders. The reason that's a good thing, I'd suggest from the point of view of patients who need these products, is the better competition we can get in these tenders, the more security of supply and the better price we will get. And so it becomes a sustainable proposition over time. So the fewer suppliers who are available globally, the more tenuous supply might be if problems arise. So we had 5 tenderers. These are leading global companies. 9 intravenous products now registered in Australia, which is compared to when we started tendering and there were 2 or 3. This is a really great thing. These are all liquid products. And then 5 subcutaneous products. Only a couple of those are the highly concentrated, more specialised subcutaneous products, but nonetheless, subcutaneous is really a market segment which has got to develop more, I think. So we awarded contracts to Grifols and CSL Behring. This is a competition. A tender in its nature is a competition. They ultimately were the winners of the competition, and the current suppliers didn't win the competition. So there is a consequence of that outcome, of course. The price outcomes in this tender, it was a highly competitive tender, were particularly favourable, and we estimate that we've achieved $30 million saving per annum going forward for these imported products. And so on the transition, these are, you may well have seen this, or the clinic may well have talked to you about it. We're going from the current imported products up to gamma and Kirby for IVIG to Flovigamma and Privigen. Flovigamma has been used in Australia before, particularly when it came into play when we had the recall of another product, and there seemed to be good feedback that there weren't any particular problems with going quickly to that product. excuse me. So we've got a 5 and a 10% Flovigamma product and 10% Privigen. And on the IVIG products, we've got a particularly good price reduction through our tendering. And I should say that even the $60 from last time, which was the 2011 tender, is far less than the $84 we started paying back in 2004 for Optigam when we first tendered. So we've had this stabilising effect over time. And then on the subcutaneous product, we now have, as the imported product, Hizentra, 20% product, high utility, it's stable at room temperature for some time. And in parallel with that, we have the domestic Evergam product. And on IV products, we also have Intragam, of course. So, now this is hard to read in detail. Am I right for time? I didn't actually notice when I started. But this is on our website. So if you want to check what the time frame is, you can find this on this at this link here. There's various materials there about the transition timing. But basically, the transition period runs up until 30 June 2015. That's when supply will cease under the current contracts. It's really up to individual hospitals and clinics to then work with their own patients, work with the Red Cross Blood Service, who is the distributor of these products, to plan when they're going to manage the transition through that period. There's no great hurry. On the other hand, it's not a particularly good idea to leave right until the last minute, probably. But we allowed, having taken into account the feedback we had from the clinical specialists we talked to, we allowed what we think is an adequate period there for an orderly, well-planned transition. I should say we work very closely with the Red Cross Blood Service, who are the distributors of the products, and also manage the authorisation process for the products. And so this link here, if you are really interested in digging into these things, also has some materials mostly intended for clinicians, but there are there is a patient fact sheet there and also on our website, which might have been given to you in a discussion at the clinic. So that's the transition. Just to mention some other things on IG, I've been talking about a couple of times about the authorisation process. Since 2008, there has been in place the criteria for use of IVIG. So this creates an eligibility framework, defines the conditions for which the products are available, and then the situation of the patient against which access is, or eligibility for access is judged. And that process happens between the clinician involved and the Red Cross. So those criteria have existed since 2008 and were updated in 2011. Now, in 2013, it's a little bit busy this, I'm afraid, but a review was done and some further measures were put in place, basically directed at ensuring that IVIG is going to the patients who most need it, and also that access access across the country is managed on an equitable and equivalent basis. So the processes for getting access and the way that's applied is consistent across the country. So there is now some extra policy in place, and the real on the ground reality of this is that there will be a new system which will be being launched, Bloodstar, I think called. It actually has a meaning within the acronym, it's not just someone's silly idea. This new system will launch in 2016, and so the records which the Blood Service currently hold in a database that they essentially manage themselves will now be held in this database, and in their authorisation role, the Blood Service will use this database in interacting with the clinicians who put the information in there to get authorisation for clinicians. The benefit of Blood Cell will be to generate some data which will then be able to be used to investigate further the most appropriate use of IVIG, generate evidence in other words. It can be the sort of reference point for further work in terms of knowledge development and research going forward about the best way to direct IVIG within the system. So, and there is a network of committees that, there are committees, this is very small, but there are committees here within each specialty. So there's a working group within immunology that interacts with the national committee, and there's a neurology group, a haematology group. This is all about ensuring that IVIG and subcutaneous IG are used in the best way over time and in a consistent way across the country. So, as I said, I hope I haven't sounded too much like a public servant. Happy to take any questions now, or I think it's the idea to have a little panel.
Yeah, we're going to have to
do either way.
Do anyone want to ask a question right now? Feel free. Yes?
Yeah, over the past 20 years and that sort of thing, obviously there's a lot of priorities coming down. Why, you know, you've been off the game for X amount of years and there may or may not have been a product staffed with K that used to play out. Now, assuming it's all got the same amount of salt and pepper and stuff in it, why would that be, and what's going to be the consequences of when they change it all from hop again?
Yeah, so at the MBA, we're not medicos or scientists, but we do make sure we get advice from the doctors. So we haven't been told that there's any concern with the changing process, the switching process. And we've made sure we ask. In fact, we do tendering for other types of products as well.
Oh, yeah.
So we make sure that we know about any issues like that. But these products are, from a clinical point of view, I'll defer to David or Matthew if they've got a contribution. But what we understand, they're essentially equivalent products. They've been produced to more or less the same specifications. There might be slight differences in, really, it's sort of almost the amount of work that companies do to prove what their products do. But fundamentally, they're being approved against the same standards, and they do the same job. And because we're buying a proportion of these through a tendering process, companies will be the winners and losers from time to time in that process.
So looking at the earlier data and the graphs, it appears that we're really dropping off with donations and local production.
Yeah. It's actually, I hate to say from the domestic point of view, but it's actually not more competitive to produce in Australia. And blood collection, it gets a little complex, but blood collection at the Red Cross is plasma for fractionation and the fresh products. The demand for the fresh products is actually declining. The demand for the plasma products is increasing, or particularly IVIG. So we have this sort of gap. And part of the problem is that it costs a lot more each
to add on for domestic supply. It costs a lot more than if you can buy than buying the product overseas. So it's really a balance these days between having a viable industry in Australia, making sure we've got resort to Australian product from a supply security point of view, but then having some of that cost offset by importation. And I'm not sure if people are, you know, have been patients for long enough to remember, but since we've done this tendering, there haven't been shortages of supply as far as we're aware. So hopefully we won't go back to the old days where there was actual shortage of product.
Most things in health, the price tends to go up.
Yeah.
How come that you're getting a lower price when presumably a lot of it is derived from blood that's actually being bought overseas from the donor, unlike Australia?
Mm.
How come you're getting it cheaper when the Australian supply would be free?
Few things happening. These companies that make the products overseas are big multinational companies, and they, over probably the last 10 years, have really created efficient industries where they're collecting a lot of plasma very efficiently in the US and Europe, really. And that all goes to making pretty competitive global industry. Now, there's a lot of the world that doesn't get products, but on the other hand, those companies want to sell to the countries who are prepared to pay something like the price they would like to charge. So we've got the benefit over the years of an expanding and more efficient industry globally. And I think in Australia, because for whatever reason governments decided to have the MBA as a single point of purchasing, we've really been able to leverage that and make good decisions about when to tender, how to tender, and get good price from companies. Sorry for banging around the drum, but that's a good part of the job. Thanks very much.
Thanks for inviting me to speak about subcutaneous immunoglobulin therapy. As mentioned in the introduction, the Canberra Hospital got together a working group to enable subcutaneous immunoglobulin therapy to be developed and initiated, implemented at the hospital. During that time, this is sort of a history of what happened at the end of midway through 2013, when the NBA was ready to announce a framework by which SCIG programs in Australia could be run. The group got together and it included representatives from the immunology and hematology department and the myself and the transfusion nurse for the ACT. As part of the working group developing the program, it just so happened to coincide with one of the companies who were importing or selling product to Australia, bringing a well-known SCIG practitioner from Scandinavia, and that was Professor Anne Garloff. A number of you may have come to her patient forum that was held at the end of 2013. It was great because she was able to give her personal experience in a very engaging manner, and it was very beneficial for us as beginners in this area to learn from her. We drafted a pilot plan and began the program at the end of 2013, and that was really just a pilot program, and we had 10 patients that came onto that program. That ran over approximately 6 months. And this is just a very simple graph that shows that during that time, of the 10 people, when people were on receiving IVIG, their grams per month dose was slightly greater than was required with subcutaneous immunoglobulin. Anyway, this is an outline of the program, as was run as a pilot program, but also now. Patients come onto the program because they've heard about subcutaneous immunoglobulin therapy that they can undertake themselves at home. So they will often speak to their specialist about it and see if they are eligible to come onto the program. There are some criteria associated with subcutaneous immunoglobulin therapy. So it really is a mix of having the specialist looking after the individual, recommending them to the program because they think the patient will do better on subcutaneous immunoglobulin therapy than they might be doing on intravenous immunoglobulin therapy. The NBA criteria specifies that there are four conditions, or I should say four criteria that have to be met in order for a specialist to be able to receive approval to prescribe subcutaneous immunoglobulin therapy, and the primary one is primary immune deficiency, second specific immune deficiency, and the others are applied in secondary immune deficiency due to hematological conditions and cancers. Anyway, at the beginning of the program, if somebody wishes to swap from intravenous therapy to subcutaneous therapy, these are the sorts of things that will happen. At the baseline, pathology will be undertaken so that we can see how you progress when you're on SCIG. But that really happens more once you've committed to swapping from IV to SCIG. And part of the commitment process is through speaking with me or a SCIG nurse, and we would be asking you what your lifestyle entails, how would SCIG benefit you traumatic for you to have monthly or second weekly doses of immunoglobulin therapy intravenously. But also take into account whether you have responded well to IVIG and whether you've suffered any serious side effects. And also your infection history and how well it has responded to treatment. Other things to consider when swapping to SCIG is the availability, your availability to come into the hospital to attend the 4-session-long program. Generally, this is run over approximately 2 weeks with 2 sessions per week. And the sessions are lengthy because during the sessions there's lots to learn if you haven't had to really practice any clinical procedures on yourself. You were accustomed to going to hospital most likely and having nurses attend to you. Anyway, at session one, that's when we perform the natural baseline pathology has been performed and through blood testing, and if it hasn't, we certainly take blood at that time. Then you would stay, and during this is a sort of an outline of what the topics are covered in every session. We talk about your diagnosis and your need for replacement immunoglobulin in order to maintain a satisfactory state of health. We try to identify whether you have somebody who lives with you or near you who can support you should you need support during the early phase, especially during the first 6 months of SCIG therapy. And we record all the contact details should they be available. Then we discuss with you what might be considered a good infusion environment in the home and how to set it up. We talk about the product, how to check it to make sure that its integrity is optimal, how to store it at home, how to transport it from the hospital back to your home, what your dose will be, and what to do about what is considered wastage and what to do about it. As indicated in with the presentation that Michael just gave you, it's a product under great demand, and we like to keep a count of what's being consumed and what's wasted, so that not only can we budget for it, but also we can be sure that if there is wastage due to accidental dropping of your vial or an already drawn up syringe or something, that you can be compensated with the next lot of supply that comes through. We talk about what subcutaneous tissue is. Well, subcutaneous tissue lies between the skin and the muscle, and it's fat tissue. And there's a diagram a bit later on that shows the optimal places for siting subcutaneous infusions. We talk about the benefits and risks of IVIG and SCIG. Now, they're very similar, except with SCIG, they are not as extreme. So the benefits are naturally that you're having antibodies in immunoglobulin replacement therapy because you are unable to make as much as you need or any or of the quality you need. But the risks are, whilst they, immunoglobulin is immunoglobulin, it's a blood product gathered from many human donors. So the risks of taking any blood product are pretty much the same. However, given that subcutaneous immunoglobulin is infused by the fat tissue, it's not taken up in the body as quickly as if it were infused directly into the venous circulation. And therefore, that has a moderating effect, and the side effects are generally much less extreme and tend to be mild most commonly. There are differences in the dosing serum immunoglobulin. We also teach you about aseptic technique, what it is and why it is so important. And that basically is to reduce any contamination by infectious agents when you're infusing your product. Techniques for ergometric and safe handling of access and delivery devices. This is just trying to teach you how to manipulate a syringe and a butterfly needle and safely, so and without contaminating it. As I said, the side effects, we talk about side effects, the local side effects. When you have something given intravenously, perhaps you may get some irritation. It's generally not the case, though. It would be considered a little unusual, in fact. However, when you're going through the skin, as was mentioned earlier, the skin covering your whole body is the first line of defence for your body. So it has it's ready to respond should it be breached in any way. And so if you don't site your needle correctly for subcutaneous infusions or injection, you can cause a bit of irritation at the site. But it tends to be mild and it's easy to deal with through over-the-counter medications like Panadol and antihistamine. More moderate side effects, people often will experience these having IVIG. They are less common when a person moves from IVIG to subcutaneous IG. And they include things like mild, headache, bit of nausea, possibly perhaps a little itching, sometimes a bit of an upset stomach. More serious side effects would include things like aseptic meningitis and a dropping of the blood pressure due to a severe response to the introduction of immunoglobulin into the body. The severe side effects, which can happen with IVIG as well, need to be treated immediately via a medical facility. In our program, we have a manual push technique that is taught, and that is that you use your hands to infuse the contents of the syringe, the immunoglobulin-holding syringes, and deliver it into the fat tissue. And it's not a quick injection, it's not like a diabetic injecting insulin or somebody who's having anticoagulant therapy and giving themselves an agent, an anticoagulant agent into subcutaneous tissue. It's an infusion and therefore it takes time. And initially, given that the fat tissue is not there with lots of spaces, just like empty balloons for you to infuse into, it takes some time for the fat tissue to build up tolerance and an ability to take the volume required in order for you to receive a satisfactory dose. We discuss what to do with your consumables. When we talk about consumables, we're not actually talking about the consumable being immunoglobulin, which you consume, but the administration sets that you use, which are supplied in this program but through the hospital, and how to dispose of the various delivery sets that have had biological agents in them and sharps. One of the most important things for me on the other end, once somebody has graduated home to home-based therapy, is the keeping of a diary. It's very handy for you to be able to follow, should you be on ski, to be able to follow your own progress. And one of the easiest ways to do it is to keep a diary. But in keeping a diary, you're able to record any wastage or any problems that you've encountered. And this you can take and use as a great point of reference when you're seeing your consultant or your ski nurse when you come into the hospital pick up product. Now, this is just a brief immunoglobulin replacement therapy. As you're probably all aware, it's there to assist You, as Michael said, there's a website, the bottom line here. The MDA has a lot of information there. That's just the home page, and you can follow the various menus to find the information that was indicated by Michael's presentation. Immunoglobulin, that's what it's all about. That's the ingredient that is constitutes the main form of therapy. And I think you've seen that before today. This is what it arrives for use in, little glass vials. They measure 5, 10, 20, 50 mils depending on the product. And anybody who might presently be on the scheme will realise that that is an empty vial without its cap, and were you to receive something like that, and it was full, you wouldn't use it because it would be tampered with. There's no cap on it. Anyway, the reason I put this up was just to give you an indication of the difference in size, except I forgot to put a scale in, compared to the volume that you'd be receiving intravenously. The volume is much reduced when using the subcutaneous immunoglobulin in specific products. They are 16 and 20% in concentration, and they're at least twice as concentrated as the products used in IVIG. For this reason, it is imperative that they are not delivered into the blood supply directly, and that's why we take great care in teaching you how to give a subcutaneous, citing a subcutaneous injection and infusing only into the fat tissue and not any even tiny blood vessels that can be found in the fat tissue. Hand washing, very important. You need to ensure that you maintain good hand hygiene as well as maintain aseptic technique, which in brief will ensure is a no-touch technique, anything that has been sterilised, and it is meant to remain sterilised until it enters the body, in the work surface. And this is what a setup, this is how simple a setup looks like. You have the vials on the top left-hand corner, and there again, they are used vials, because I don't want to take vials out of the fridge and take them out of the cold chain pool. Basically, it's a matter of using a drawing up needle, which is in the top line next to the butterfly needles. The butterfly, that is used to access the fluid along with a syringe. Once the syringe is filled, it's disconnected and attached to a butterfly, which is in the top right-hand corner. You can see why it's called the butterfly, because the two little flanges at the side look a bit like butterfly wings, and they're used to help actually put the needle in its proper place. Sometimes you need to draw up more than one syringe from a vial, and should this happen, and you've got more than one syringe to go into one infusion site, then you'd have to cap. You would have to cap the syringe. So there's a little red cap there. You've probably seen those used when you visited the hospital. And strangely enough, those cotton balls on the tape are actually to fix the once you've drawn up your immunoglobulin into the syringe and connected it to the butterfly and primed it and are ready to inject. You use, once you've sighted the butterfly in your injection site, you keep it in place by keeping the angle with a cotton bud and some tape. So it's pretty simple. It's nothing too fancy or technical. And these are the injection sites that can be used. The main one used that I recommend over most is actually the abdominal sites. that is because they assist with mobility. If you're able to fix your butterflies to your abdomen and you want to be doing things with your hands, if you've got elasticated trousers or trousers with large pockets, you can just slip the syringe in and be using your hands and move around quite freely. Whereas if you have them in your arms or your thighs, it's a little more difficult to move around. But these sites more likely to be used with pediatric patients who might be having an infusion over a slightly longer time period and via an infusion pump, that is the amyloids. Subcutaneous injection site, as you can see here, you've got the epidermis and the dermis, and the fat lies below that before you get muscle. And it's really important that you get it. Absolutely, these needles don't quite go deeply enough into the fat for my liking. If you go into the skin, you're more likely to have a greater reaction with redness, hotness, itching, and discomfort. And it's not at all recommended. Right, I just want to give you an idea of what a patient diary looks like. People might think, oh, how tedious, I have to fill this in. But once you're in a routine, it's very helpful, and it's certainly very helpful for your care team, your medical care team, to review what's going on, what changes might be required with your therapy at home. And basically, that's it. Our program is looking into the future. Of course, this program is about really supporting patients more individually by tailoring their, to a degree, your immunoglobulin replacement therapy. So through the delivery of product, at the moment it's a monthly system where you pick up product. We're hoping that that can be taken up to 2 months or quarterly at some stage. But that's not up to us, that's mandated by the national program via the NBA and ARCBS. Supplies of administration sets come from us, and we would like to see in the future that, if possible, we can have supplies actually sent out to you rather than picking up the hospital, but that's still a work in progress. Now, to date, we have been running the program as a one-on-one education program where you come in, one would come in 3 to 4 times over a period of a fortnight. That's very labour intensive from a staffing point of view, and we're looking at the Scandinavian model where they actually have an 8-week program, which might horrify some of you. We have to come in weekly over 8 weeks and you are part of a group. We're not suggesting that that would be the case, but certainly if we had groups of perhaps 3 people at a time, it would be less onerous on our staffing. When it comes to switching from the products that have been available to date to the ones that are now coming, are now available due to the tender process that Michael mentioned, we hope to actually use a group session to undertake that. And we're planning to do that in March. Once we have the accommodation in the hospital sorted out and booked, and we'll be notifying you of the dates and expecting you to RSVP for the most convenient date for you. There won't be 1 or 2 dates given, I'm afraid. Anyway, we can keep in contact over that. We do have one pediatric patient that was switched from IVIG to SCIG at Canberra Hospital, but we also have a couple of patients who have been who are seen elsewhere but received their product through us, so whilst they're part of our budget, they're not really looked after our program. In a medical clinical sense. However, there are a couple of pediatric patients who are keen to try and switch to SCIG, and we anticipate doing that during the school holidays. That's it. Oh, I should just say that it's not too difficult to learn the process of giving oneself an injection and learn how to set up, look after your product, etc. But some patience is required because it really does take around 3 months for you to settle into a routine and for you to become more tolerant of the product and the treatment and the changes in your inner body levels from very high peaks to troughs to a more eventually stable level. And it takes some time for the side effects, especially moderate side effects that may be experienced with IVIG and initially with skin. It does take approximately 3 months for those to become less and less, and usually they disappear. That's the experience I've had to date. So we had 10 people on our pilot program, and we have had another 10 come on, but a couple have also reverted to IVIG for various reasons, either medical or social. So that's it. If you have any questions or would like to learn more, you can ask me now. And unfortunately, I forgot to put on the our generic email address, which is TCH, standing for Cam Hospital, SCI. So it's tchscig@act.gov.au. Thank you. Peak in the body.
IV treatment being phased out?
No, I don't think it's being phased out. It's used for other conditions as well, IVIG, and not just immune deficiency. So it's used more broadly than just for IG replacement therapy. And so for other conditions that have require much higher doses to be therapeutic, you need much larger doses in the whole body. So it's not, SCID is not appropriate for them, at least clinically. And so IVIG won't be phased out because of that. Perhaps there'll be a greater move in Scandinavia. Everybody who requires immunoglobulin replacement therapy rather than immunomodulation therapy, they are placed automatically on subcutaneous immunoglobulin. But I'm sure should people, for one reason or another, not be able to do it or fail for some reason, IVIG would be available. And it certainly is the way the majority of the people receive their immunoglobulin replacement therapy at this moment. Yes?
Yeah. Lots of practicalities. If you have a need to travel, the transport of the agreements with customers and other countries.
IFRA is a wonderful network for talking to other people who are members. We have a number of people in this audience who have travelled abroad and domestically using SCID, and they have done it very successfully. I hope they join IFRA and share all their experiences with people. If they do that, we have to identify themselves and discuss it. But there has been no problem with customs, either with the you do require an export permit, and that is organised through us, through the Australian Red Cross Support Service. But the products that do not require cold chain storage permit for taking travelling. And you can, once you've sort of settled it, have a regime in place, you can decide when you're going to have your therapy. You don't have to have it on a booked date. So you can normally, if you have a large dose, you want to infuse twice a week. You might say have a routine of infusing on a Monday and Thursday. However, should your social life keep you busy and out at Christmas time and you're very busy, you don't need to have it on the Monday or the Thursday. You can do it out of the week forward and on Sunday or the following day after. You can manipulate it somewhat as long as you generally get a fortnightly dose within that fortnight and then the second fortnight the same. Otherwise, if you didn't do that, you would be reverting to a monthly type dosing regime, which is just sort of doesn't make sense with SCID. You would might as well have another budget.
Yes, Dr.
It's been 2 days since my last immunoglobulin.
I'm going to tell you a little bit today about my personal journey with PID and with immunoglobulin. It's now, I think, 24 years since I was first diagnosed as being immune deficient, which means that I've got a couple more years to go before I've been immune deficient for half my life. Which means, from my perspective, I can no longer tell, I can no longer really remember what life was like before immunoglobulin came into it. I was diagnosed with an immune deficiency when I was 19, in my second year at university. I initially was diagnosed because I was hospitalised with something called ITP, which idiopathic thrombocytopenia purpura, which means I had almost no platelets and had a lovely collection of blood spots all over my arms and legs while I was internally bleeding. Being hospitalised with that at 19, I gather, is relatively unusual, and I decided to do a bit of checking to see what was happening and took a bone marrow biopsy. And the bone marrow biopsy showed that my immunoglobulin levels were almost non-existent. At the time, I was told I had hypogammaglobulinemia, which is a particular type of immune deficiency. That diagnosis has subsequently been changed to CVID, which is by far the most common of the primary immune deficiencies. I started getting treated at age 19 with monthly infusions of immunoglobulin, back in the days when it was Intragam rather than Intragam P, and that was the only product that you could get in Australia. The ITP for me didn't go away, and when I was 21, I had a splenectomy to stop my spleen destroying my platelets. So I have an impressive scar that runs across here from that. That did stop the platelets going, but unfortunately it didn't make my immune system work any better. One of the biggest challenges for me early on in adjusting to being immune deficient and having regular treatment was learning to cope with needles. I used to be incredibly needle phobic. I think I probably still am, but I've had enough experience getting them now to cover up for that most of the time. And that becomes a bit more of an issue, and I'll tell you a little bit later on about subcutaneous for me. One of the questions for me, or one of the things I wonder about, is we saw earlier when David was talking about the 10 early warning signs of PID. And one of the things I do is look back and say, were there early warning signs that I was immune deficient? And there were a couple. I had a history of recurrent infections, and infections that would need two or three or more courses of antibiotics before they'd go away. I also had a history of poor vaccine response. When I was young, I was immunised for everything you could be immunised against, and I had everything you could be immunised against, despite the vaccinations. But in many ways, I think I'm one of the luckier people in terms of being diagnosed with immune deficiency. I was diagnosed after my first major illness. There were those other warning signs, but the first hospital admission for me for something connected to my immune deficiency, I had a specialist who managed to work out what was happening and come up with a diagnosis. I think the figures that Christine was showing us at the beginning of today showed that for many people that can take upwards of 10 years. So I think for me, that quick diagnosis has helped me get the treatment I needed earlier and has hopefully helped to keep me better than I would have been otherwise. One of the things, I've heard other people give sessions on immune deficiency in the past, and they've talked about common variable immune deficiency comes in two versions. There's a version where you're just immune deficient, and there's a version where there's a lot of autoimmune complications that come along with it as well. And I'm lucky enough to have the autoimmune complications as well. The platelets for me was the first sign of that, but I've had a few other things as well. The most worrying one was autoimmune hemolytic anemia, when my body decided that red blood cells were a bad thing and it should get rid of them. I also had some ongoing issues with my gut and digestive system. And I seem to do quite well at having allergies. Given that most allergies are immune-based, you probably shouldn't have allergies if you're immune deficient, but I seem to specialise in them. I guess those autoimmune things are something that's come out over time. One of the other things I wanted to talk about over time is over that sort of journey of 20 or 25 years, a couple of the biggest things for me along that way have been starting work when I finished university and got a full-time job, and starting a family. Starting work was a challenge for me because I used to have one day every 4 weeks, and then over time that shifted to a half a day every 2 weeks where I'd have to go off and have treatment. So I had to have that chat with my boss and say, well, you know, I need to go to hospital for the equivalent of a day a month. I need to be in hospital. I don't really want to use my sick leave for that, because if I do that, I have none left when I get sick. And coming up with a flexible working arrangement, a flexible working arrangement that allowed me to take that time off work and make it up in other ways. That's generally worked well. I also have periodic bouts, as most people with immune deficiency do, where I get sicker. I think in the last 12 months, I'm now down to only one hospital admission in 12 months, which is pretty good for me. I have to have a relatively understanding employer as well, who's happy to say there will be some times where we'll get a phone call or a text message from Adam on a Monday morning that says, sorry, I'm in hospital, I'll probably be back at work in a few weeks. Some jobs cope with that better than others, and I think I'm probably lucky that I've found an employer and a job that's reasonably accommodating around all of that. In terms of starting a family, that was quite a challenge for me and for my partner to try and work out if we were going to have children, were we going to create children who were immune deficient? Not that there's anything wrong with being immune deficient, but if I had a choice, I wouldn't wish it on my children. When we decided to have children, we talked to my immunologist, Matthew, and we asked him what he could tell us and whether, you know, what were my chances, was a child guaranteed to be immune deficient or not. This was back in 2006-2007 that we were having that talk, and Matthew's advice at the time was that there were very few genetically identified causes of immune deficiency then, or the type that I had. Matthew wasn't aware of what caused mine, and the only answer we had was that it was a combination of genes, and I would probably be unlikely to pass that combination on to my children. We've gone on that advice and had three children. None of them at the moment are immune deficient, and we're very pleased about that. But that probably brings me to talk about a little more about one of my issues with immune deficiency, or one of the things that's happened to me on my journey, which is around genetic research. In Matthew's presentation earlier, he talked about the ANSARDA study. I'm one of the patients involved in that study. And my genome has been sequenced, I don't know how extensively, but a fair bit of it. And many of my immediate family have certainly had some genetic testing done, and for some of them, blood testing done. At the moment, we think we're quite close to understanding what makes me immune deficient. And I will give a very botched explanation of that Matthew will later tell me how badly I've done. As I understand it, they've found two gene sequences in my genome that are not what you'd expect to find. So there's two places where my genome varies from what you would normally expect. And those two points are related to how the immune system functions. The current thinking is those two variations I have are what make me immune deficient. And I think, I'll try and get it right, normally it doesn't matter because there's no one listening and understands if I get it wrong. But I think with those gene variants, one of those gene variants is present in my sister and in my father, but not anywhere else in my family. And one of them is unique to me, so no one else has it. Which is probably good news for my wider extended family, that if they haven't got it, they're probably okay. The other thing that we've talked about with those genes is that we think, it's hard to tell because there's only me that has it, we think those two gene variants are necessary but not sufficient, which means I have to have them to be immune deficient, but having those two gene variants doesn't make me immune deficient. There's been some other environmental trigger in my life that has sort of switched on the immune deficiency. That raises a bit of a a challenge for my partner and I to think about whether we should genetically test those three children we've got, now that we know some more about me. Matthew's advice to us has been that it's based on two variants that I carry. The chances genetically of passing those on to any child are 1 in 4. My partner Emily's answer to that is we've only had 3 kids, we haven't had 4. But I guess from our perspective, that means there's a chance that each of those kids we've got may be carrying that same gene combination as me and maybe have the necessary but not sufficient trigger for an immune deficiency. At the moment, we've chosen not to find out whether they have it or not. And I think for us, it's about knowing that they're well now. And not wanting to find out any more about that. But we can test them if we need to. Sorry, I don't normally talk with my family sitting in the audience. The other thing that I wanted to talk about today that brings me to my show and tell is to talk about subcutaneous immunoglobulin. I moved on to subcutaneous immunoglobulin with Anastasia and I've got my Sharps container that I use to put my Sharps in. This is a small one for when I travel. As you can tell, it's used to see all the reds go out to the hospital. This is my little bag I've done at home with 8 of these to get me through the month, which has all the consumables that Anastasia was showing on the slide before. I've got my syringes and a couple of bulk linings and the airways that I put into the immunoglobulin bottles or the wipes to make sure there's no germs on the surface of the skin or anything like that. And there's one more here I've got that Anastasia can get out of the fridge, but I didn't because I have to use it tomorrow anyway. I brought along a bottle of the Gammamore that I use for my treatment. So when Anastasia was talking about the size of bottles, this is 20 mils of immunoglobulin, of solution for me to use that has, I think, 3.3 grams of immunoglobulin in it. I use 2 of these bottles twice a week. So I normally do every Sunday night and every Thursday night. You can see this one's still got the blue cap on, but Anastasia will take it off on hers. And I have a special shelf in the fridge at home that starts off at the beginning of the month full of these and gradually dwindles down until I get the next month's supply. And one of the things I like about this compared to the IVIG is that this can stay out of the fridge for up to 2 months at 25 degrees Celsius or below. Someone was asking before about travelling with it. I've recently done a 5-week camping trip through regional New South Wales in Queensland with a camper trailer. We started off at the beginning of the trip with half of our Esky full of these, and by the time we finished, had enough room to fit food in as well. And we found it was surprisingly easy to travel and do this. I'm not sure how pleased Anastasia would have been about the technique we managed. We did the best aseptic technique we could when camping at the beach. And we managed to do reasonably well, but it wouldn't be what I'd call a hospital aseptic technique. But we managed to make sure that none of the stuff that was sterile came into contact with anything that shouldn't come into contact. And yes, for 5 weeks we managed to do that, where twice a week I'd sit down in the tent or the kids went to the beach and run or whatever and I'd do my treatment. The biggest difference I found camping was that when I do it at home, I do it after the children have gone to bed. But when you're camping in a tent, it's just too hard to do it at night, so I had to do it in the daylight and I could actually see what I was doing. One of the other things I say about subcutaneous, for me, the biggest challenge was learning to put the needle into myself. I said I was needle phobic, I think I still am. And when I was learning, I told Anastasia that I wasn't convinced that I could sit and look at my tummy and stick a needle into it. I'm not sure Anastasia's thrilled about me talking about the advice she gave me at the time, but I found it really useful. She told me I wasn't trying to hit a vein, I was trying to hit my tummy. It was reasonably hard to miss. So I get it all lined up, to begin with, I get it all lined up, get the needle sort of that close, Then I looked away at something else and stick it in. So I wasn't looking when the needle went in. After 18 months of practice, I can now look quite easily and I'm okay with it. But it probably took me 6 months to learn. And there was a question as well about the time it takes people. I have a reasonably large dose at about 40 mils. When I first started off, it would take me about an hour and a half to do the process of setting everything up and laying it all out and getting the needles in and sitting down and doing it and then cleaning everything up afterwards. Over time, I've gotten much better at my technique with setting it all up and much more confident and do it quicker. And over time, I can also inject, I think Anastasia said over time, you may find you can do it a little quicker. The whole process from end to end now takes me about an hour. And for me, that's a bit of a milestone because that means that the amount of time I spend over a fortnight doing this at home is about the same as the amount of time I used to spend a fortnight sitting in a hospital room getting it done. But I'm choosing to do it at home at a time that suits me. And for me, that break even of knowing I'm not spending any more time doing it was psychologically important. I think the other thing I'd say about one of my reasons for choosing the subcutaneous was for the lifestyle choice of being able to go camping for 5 weeks and take it with me. The other reason was the hope that it would improve my health over time. And I think I'm starting to see some of that. I talked before about how I have autoimmune complications. I used to often find that after I had my intravenous infusion and my levels were really sky high, I get some autoimmune complications. I'd be less well because of that. Then over the next few weeks as my levels drop down, I'd start to almost fall sick towards the end as my levels got really low, and that lethargy that many of you on IVIG would know would start to kick in. I've found on the subcut that instead of my levels going up and down, they're floating most of the time at somewhere between 8 and 9, which for me is incredibly healthy. I used to go from about 18 down to about 6. Floating at 8 or 9 all the time is really for me getting rid of a lot of those negative bits I used to have at the start and the end of each cycle. I don't know that it works the same for everyone, but for me that's been empowering to know that I feel the same all the time and that some of those less good bits aren't there anymore. Just trying to think if there's anything else I want to talk about. Probably, it's a couple of other things I might talk about quickly. One of them is around patient support. When I was first diagnosed in the early 1990s, there wasn't much in the way of patient support available. There was no patient body in Australia like there is now, and there was not really an internet, so I couldn't go and look up Dr. Google and see what he told me about what I had and what I needed. I've seen some of that support come along the way, and I think now, with the messages I wanted to say to everyone today, is if you're not already a member of the ADFA, you should sign up and join before you leave today. You don't ever have to use it if you don't want to, but it gives you a way into a national patient organisation that knows something about what you've got, and maybe I'll give you information that will help you along the way. I think there are still some weaknesses in the way we have information and what we have available. I think one of the bigger weaknesses, I think we're getting better at having support for people who have primary immune deficiencies. I think we still need to do better at supporting the families that are there as well. I think a lot of the time, the one who's got the immune deficiency is relatively easy because everyone's used to giving them support, but the rest of their family members have to work out on their own and what to do. And I might just finish by talking a little bit more about the ADFA as I finish up. I joined the ADFA after grandparents and came along to the meeting and signed up afterwards. I joined the board shortly after that and spent six years as the chair before I resigned as the chair but stayed on the board this October. The reason I've spent so much time in it is that I think it's important for people with immune deficiencies to have a strong voice, and I think having a national patient organisation makes us a stronger voice than we give on our own. The IDFA spent a long time advocating for subcutaneous immunoglobulin to be available. I'm sure Michael will tell you we weren't the only people advocating for that, and many other people have been banging on about it for a long time as well. But I'd like to think that having a patient organisation talking about it helped to make it easier to get that treatment available for other people to use. And I think for me, it's that advocacy on behalf of people that's very important. I should also note, Michael talked about there being a range of committees that the National Blood Authority uses to keep track of all that it's meant to be doing. You're all lucky enough to have me as your representative on one of those committees. The IDFA was invited to nominate a patient representative for the National Immunology and Governance Advisory Group, which is a bit of a mouthful, but with the words Immunology and Governance Advisory in it, means that it gives us a chance as a patient organisation, or as patients, to have some say in what's happening with the products that we use nationally. Hopefully you're happy with the job I'm doing with that, but you probably don't know if you're not. I think that's probably, there is one other thing I have to show you before I finish up. Two other things. One of them is my pump. So this is what I use to pump the immunoglobulin into it a couple of times a week. Mine is one of the bigger ones because my dose is fairly big. It's got a little bit of flips up here, and this, when you turn it on, it travels along with it to load the syringe in, and that goes up over the top to hold it into place. And then I set the rate that needs to go at and sit in front of the television with it on my lap, and it pumps the stuff into me over 45 minutes or so. So that's an example of what a subcutaneous pump looks like. And the last thing I have in my show and tell is the patient diary that Anastasia was talking about as well. So this is my Gaminorm patient diary. And there's a page here that I'm halfway through for December. It has a section up the top where I fill in the amount of product I've received. And I talk about if I do anything like lose one of my bottles or something, I have to say what's happened to them. I don't think saying left to be a clinical lecture would be an acceptable excuse. So and as I use it, the batch number stickers from each bottle get stuck on me when I use them, along with a comment about how much I put in, where I put it, how long it took, and anything that happened along the way that my doctors may be interested in. I find it's actually really useful for me as well as for Anastasia and the doctors. But for me, when I go in to see my immunologist every quarter or so, I can say, and they say how things have been going, I say, well, they've been okay, but when I look here, I can see on this day this happened, and on this day this happened, and you know how I've been talking about being itchy, you can see here I've had itchy arms and legs for 3 months continuously. Well, it gives me a chance to talk about things, and have some evidence to go with it, that I'm not very good at keeping on my own if I don't have a diary that forces me to do it. So that's a little bit about patient perspective or a journey with immune deficiency, and I'm happy to take questions if anyone has this. I used to have the intravenous by meal. I managed that up over time to pick a couple of favourite places and just to usually go and just go in here. I still have no veins left on the top of my hand from early treatment. And I think for me there was discussion that as I got older I would find I may need a port because my veins were getting difficult. That I guess for me is one of the advantages of subcutaneous. My tummy fat doesn't seem to be changing as I keep injecting into it. Although maybe there's a little bit more than there was.
mentioned earlier that you've done some genetic testing. That's not something that my immunologist and I have discussed. Is it something that's available through your normal patient immunologist relationship, or is it something that's done as part of study?
Well, it depends. So it depends on the nature of the immune deficiency and what is suspected. So in some cases we know a lot already about which genes lead to a particular form of immune deficiency. So it can become a relatively routine process to see whether that can be confirmed in a particular patient. It's true, though, that in some situations, even where we know about the genes, actually testing for them can still be a big problem. Some forms of immune deficiency where there are many known genes that can be responsible. And at present, the methods that are available through routine practice don't necessarily make all of those tests available. Expect that sometime in the near future that will change. And then the third situation is where someone might have an immune deficiency where the genetic basis is not very well understood, especially common variable immune deficiency. And that's why we're doing the ANZARDA study and tackling this through the Centre for Personalised Immunology. So that remains a research project. But it is a national project, and anyone who's interested in enrolling can contact us about that.
I might note for that as well that while I'm talking about results that Matthew's been able to get on studying me now, I think I signed up for that study in somewhere around 2006, and for a couple of years heard nothing. And then had some initial testing, but it's only really been the last 3 or 4 years, I think, where there's been a considerably more interest in me as an individual and what's causing mine. So it's not necessarily a quick process by any means.
We've always been very interested. But it is true, research is frustratingly slow, as I outlined before. The task is substantial because of the complexity of the human genome. But we do have methods. The reason that things have started to move ahead is because of these methodological breakthroughs. Because of the uncertainty in our about the precise mechanisms that lead to immune deficiency, it's possible that the genetic abnormalities are not the complete explanation. It's also the fact that there's some variation, you know, even when there is more than one person in a family who's affected. Sometimes different members of the family are affected in different ways. Sometimes different families who harbour a similar genetic abnormality have different manifestations. And that includes differences in the timing of onset of the immune deficiency. So for these reasons, we wonder about other factors that might be contributing, including environmental factors.
I was just wondering if there's been any progress with people who have CVID being able to get things like life insurance and comprehensive travel insurance, due to insurers being unaware of CVID. They seem reluctant to provide. I've got my own business and not having life insurance and living with the concern at home, so
I can probably talk a little about that from the IDFA perspective. I think the IDFA is able to offer some advice. It obviously varies depending on each individual, what their circumstances are, but we have some travel insurance, particularly we have travel insurance companies that we know have given insurance to people with CVID in the past. Sometimes people find as well that there can be interesting variations in what you're able to get cover for. I know that when I've been able to get overseas travel insurance, they've refused to cover me for pneumonia because once when I went overseas, I got pneumonia when I was coming back. But they haven't explicitly said I'm not covered for CVID. So while I've never pushed them and tried to make a claim for it, I've looked at that and said, well, look, if they're saying they won't cover me for pneumonia and they won't cover me for sinusitis, provided I don't wind up in hospital for those two things, they'll cover me for anything else. So sometimes it's about finding the loopholes as well. I don't know at the IDFA level whether we've talked about life insurance so much, but it's maybe still worth checking whether there's any advice that the staff have on that they're able to pass through. We're also happy to talk with people and encourage them to talk to their immunologists about some of the questions you can ask or some of the things you can talk to the companies about.
So they have to say, what evidence would you need from my doctor
to show them that I'm more likely to die than anyone else?
Something like that.
I know we have some examples of our immunologists being able to change their mind based on the immunologist coming to the discussion.
As a parent, to say thanks to all of you giving up a Saturday afternoon. It's really reassuring and heartening, thinking back to when we didn't know what was triggering the various conditions that Bill went through. We've learned a lot since. There's a few fewer unknowns, so to speak. And I just wanted to express my appreciation for giving the Saturday to talk to us.
Professor Matthew Cool,
Michael Stone. And and just behind the scenes, Jenny Trill, if you want to come down, she did a lot of the organising, and we have a certificate for you as well. And thank you all again for coming, and thank you to So I would like to thank the speakers, obviously. Also Madeline, Nicole, Carol Gere, Ed Bertram from the GCSMR, and for their help with this meeting, and obviously the Australian National University for providing the venue and the afternoon tea, which was delicious. So thank you to all of those people, and hopefully we'll possibly see you again next year, but otherwise, if you want to become an IDFA member, or if you want any other information, we'll be outside. Thank you again for giving up your Saturday afternoon as well. Thank you.